The Christians, the Muslims, more than half of humanity. And if you want to add the Hindus because of this misinterpretation of Brahman, which is a valid theory, then in fact almost two-thirds of humanity looks up to this one figure of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And that is exactly what our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is told, that you have a great role model to look up to in Ibrahim. And Allah says in the Quran, the closest followers to Ibrahim are this Prophet, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those who follow him. The closest follower to Ibrahim is the descendant of Ibrahim, and that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah tells us in the Quran, and he tells the Quraysh of Mecca, that this is the religion of your own father, millata abikum Ibrahim. This is the religion of your forefather, Ibrahim alayhi salam. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn patience, we learn perseverance. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn commitment and dedication. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to stand up and preach the truth, even if everybody else rejects it. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to be a brave person. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn patience and persecution. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to follow the commandments of Allah, even if that's at great pressure to oneself and to one's family. And from the story of Ibrahim, we learn what happens when you dedicate your life to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you back more, much more in this world and the next. Indeed, there is a great role model for all of us in Ibrahim alayhi salam and for those who follow him. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-azim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bima fihi min al-ayati wa dhikr al-hakim aqulu ma tasma'un wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum wa li sa'il muslimin min kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim.
Astaghfirullah.
Only has Ishmael. And he is told in the Quran that you love your son, but Allah has told you to sacrifice your son for Allah. Allah has told you that to get rid of this son. Allah wants you to now eliminate him. And not just, Allah is not just going to take him a regular death. It's not just going to be a disease. It's not going to be an accident. You, by your own hands, have to lie him down in the sand and raise up a knife and sacrifice, a human sacrifice. Even though our religion doesn't allow this, but Allah tested Ibrahim. Ibrahim didn't know it's a test, right? Ibrahim didn't know it's a test. And so he is told, with your own hands, get rid of this object of love, because only I am worthy of devotion. It was a test to see who he loved more, Allah or his son. Can you imagine at the age of 95, at the age of 95, one son he has. He thinks he's about to die in a few years, he has no progeny left. The amount of love he must have for this child. And now he is told, I have to sacrifice you. And so he obeys the commandment of Allah Azza wa Jal. And he takes the teenager Ismail, and we are told in the Quran, Ismail said to his father, do as you have been told, I too believe in Allah. Can you imagine a 13-year-old with such iman and faith? And so he lays him down, and he raises the axe, he raises the sword, and he hesitates. And of course shaitan appears in front of him. And shaitan says, have you gone crazy? Have you gone mad? He is your only son. What are you doing? How can you kill him? And Ibrahim knows this is Satan. This is shaitan the accursed. And so he pelts him with 7 stones. And at that very point, to this day, millions of pilgrims are pelting the Jamratul Kubra. And shaitan goes away. So Ibrahim doesn't want to remain in the same place, so he goes to another place to make sure shaitan doesn't come back. Once again, shaitan comes back. Once again, he pelts him with 7 stones. And once again, he takes him to another place. And those 3 places, Jamratul Kubra, Jamratul Sughra, Jamratul Wusta, to this day, the very point that Ibrahim alayhi salam tried to sacrifice his son, we commemorate it. The pilgrims commemorate it. They will commemorate it 3 days in a row. On the 10th and the 11th and the 12th, some of them even the 13th, they're going to stone these pillars as a symbol that shaitan will never cause me to come between me and the commandments of Allah. I will obey the commandments of Allah regardless of whatever. And so when he displayed this determination, And he raised up the axe, as Allah says in the Quran, فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَ وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ. When he laid his son on the sacrificial stone, and the knife is up in the air, and he is now about to lower this and kill his own son. Allah knows there is sincerity. That is when the commandment comes down. Stop! You have fulfilled what Allah told you to do. قَدْ صَدَّقْتَ الرُّؤْيَا. Allah doesn't want human sacrifice from us, but Allah wanted to test Ibrahim. And Ibrahim won with flying colors. Here is a lamb, O Ibrahim. Sacrifice this ram instead of your son. And so to this day, every one of us on Saturday or Sunday or Monday, every one of us, either we've sent money somewhere or we ourselves are going to go and sacrifice a sheep or a goat or a lamb or a cow or a camel. All around the world, millions of animals will be sacrificed commemorating the spirit of Ibrahim alayhi salam, commemorating the sincerity of Ibrahim, commemorating the passion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. His son grows older and Allah tells him, you are going to build the first house of worship, the first mosque, the first church, the first synagogue. There has never been a house of worship on this earth before. You, O Ibrahim, are going to build the first house of worship. And to this day, that house is venerated by billions of people around the world. They face it when they pray. To this day, every single year, hundreds of millions of pilgrims perform the Umrah and the Hajj. Right now, as we speak, 2-3 million people are doing tawaf, and they will do tawaf tomorrow and the day after tomorrow and the next few days. And they will do hundreds of millions of tawafs because they're doing multiple tawafs. Non-stop from the time of Ibrahim up until the day of judgment, to commemorate that spirit of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is blessed with another son to show him gratitude, to give him thanks. And that son is Isaac and Ishaq. And Allah says that from the both of them shall be great nations. From the both of them shall be great nations. And so from Ishaq come forth all of the prophets of Israel and the children of Israel. From Ishaq come forth David and Solomon. From Ishaq come forth Jesus Christ. From Ishaq come forth all of the prophets of the Old Testament. And the Jews are the descendants of Ishaq. And from Ismail comes forth the Arab race. And from Ismail comes forth the final and the seal of all prophets. And that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ibrahim was so righteous and pious that every single prophet that came after him was from his progeny. From his two sons, Ismail and Ishaq. No other prophet came except that he was from the children of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this shows us what happens when you dedicate your life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِذْ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ. Remember when Allah tested Ibrahim with a series of commandments and he fulfilled all of them. He fulfilled all of those commandments. And when he did so, Allah says, قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. I shall make you a leader amongst men. And how true is that? The greatest venerated human being, the most number of people in the world who venerate one person, that is the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Jews, the Christians, the Muslims, more than half of humanity. And if you want to add the Hindus because of this misinterpretation of Brahman, which is a valid theory, then in fact almost 2/3 of humanity looks up to this one figure of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And that is exactly what our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is told, that you have a great role model to look up to in Ibrahim. And Allah says in the Quran, the closest followers to Ibrahim are this Prophet, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and those who follow him. The closest follower to Ibrahim is the descendant of Ibrahim, and that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah tells us in the Quran, and he tells the Quraysh of Mecca, that this is the religion of your own father, Millata Abikum Ibrahim. This is the religion of your forefather, Ibrahim alayhi salam. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn patience, we learn perseverance. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn commitment and dedication. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to stand up and preach the truth, even if everybody else rejects it. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to be a brave person. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn patience and persecution. From the story of Ibrahim, we learn what it means to follow the commandments of Allah, even if that's at great pressure to oneself and to one's family. And from the story of Ibrahim, we learn what happens when you dedicate your life to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you back more, much more in this world and the next. Indeed, there is a great role model for all of us in Ibrahim alayhi salam and for those who follow him. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-azim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bima fihi min al-ayati wa dhikr al-hakim aqulu ma tasma'un wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum wa li sa'il muslimin min kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. Alhamdulillah al-wahid al-ahad al-fard al-samad al-ladhi lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufwan ahad wa ba'du. Tomorrow is of course the day of al-hajj al-akbar. Tomorrow is the day of Arafah. Tomorrow is the holiest day of the entire year. And for those who are at the plain of Arafat, then of course our hearts go out to them in happiness and joy and in jealousy, a positive jealousy. We're allowed to be jealous here. We're jealous that they are blessed with this great opportunity to stand on the very plains of Arafat, a plain that we are told Allah Azza wa Jalla himself descends down to, and he boasts to the angels, look at these people gathered in front of me. Look at how tired and dusty and disheveled they are. Look, they have come to me from all over the world. What do they want? They want my pleasure. O angels, testify that I will give them all that they want and more than this. Indeed, those who are on that plain are blessed and fortunate. And we pray that one day, inshallah, we too can go regularly to this great pilgrimage of Hajj. But for those who are not, for those of us who are here, the day as well is a blessed day. It is a holy day. And our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ said that the one who fasts on this day shall have all of his sins of the previous and the next year forgiven. 2 full years of the minor sins, obviously not the major sins. 2 full years. It's a blessed and holy day. And it is authentically narrated that the tabi'un and the scholars of the past who did not go for Hajj, they would spend their time in the masjid and in the worship of Allah. And they would say, if I cannot be with them in body, at least I'm with them in my spirit. At least I'm doing what they're doing in dua, in dhikr. Therefore, today, tomorrow, and even Eid and the days after Eid, because in one hadith the Prophet ﷺ said the best day of the year is Yawm al-Nahr, which is the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah. And so the 9th and the 10th are competing with one another for which one is the best day, and both have their fadila or excellence each in its own way. So the 9th and the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah, which is what we are currently experiencing tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, these are indeed the most blessed days of the year. So our Prophet ﷺ said, therefore increase in it your remembrance of Allah, your dhikr, your takbir and tahmid and tahleel, to say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. These are the days of celebration. The celebration for what? For having been guided to the worship of Allah, for having been guided to the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. These are the days of rejoice. These are the days of sacrifice. These are the days where we think about Ibrahim alayhi salam and we learn from his life all of these magnificent lessons. For those who are fasting today as well, alhamdulillah, even better, because it is mustahab to fast one day before Saturday if you're going to only fast Saturday. However, it is completely permissible to fast Saturday by itself. And so for those who are not fasting today, make sure that inshallah ta'ala we make a concerted effort to fast tomorrow. And of course the fasting on the 10th is not allowed because that is the day of Eid. And so from the day of Eid, the 10th, the 11th and the 12th, and even up until the 13th, these are days that we try to do our sacrifices. These are days that we are extra charitable. These are days that we increase our adhkar, we increase our dhikr. After every salah on these days, we raise the takbirat. For 3 days, we raise the takbirat, beginning from the salat al-eid. And then working up until the Asr of the third day, we raise our voices and we say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, walillahi alhamd. We say these takbirat, these tahmidat, these tahlilat, we say them continuously, not just after the salawat, but morning and evening, day and night, because these are the days where we commemorate what Ibrahim alayhi salam did, and that is done by worshipping Allah, by increasing in our reliance upon Him, by remembering Him morning and evening, and by worshipping Him the way that the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam worshipped Him. I conclude this khutbah with a beautiful hadith, a hadith that is relevant to all that I have said. It is reported in Tirmidhi that our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went up to the journey of al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, as the ascension, the miraculous journey, and he came back down and he told us, I met my father Ibrahim. I met my father Ibrahim alayhi salam, and his back was taking a rest on Al-Bayt Al-Ma'mur. Al-Bayt Al-Ma'mur, as many of you know, this is the equivalent of the Kaaba of the angels. The angels have their equivalent of the Kaaba. The angels have a holy structure as well. And they do tawaf around it like we do tawaf around the Kaaba on earth. And they visit it like we visit the Kaaba on earth. And so Ibrahim, it is befitting that he is occupying that Baytul Ma'mur because he built the Kaaba on earth. And I saw him in Baytul Ma'mur. And when he saw me, he said to me, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أقرئ أمتك مني السلام. I want you to give my salams to your ummah. Ibrahim alayhi salam is giving us his greetings through our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I want you to tell them that paradise is a beautiful place and that its waters are luscious and cold, and that its soil is fertile, but it is barren. A Jannah that is barren? How can that be a Jannah? Our Prophet Ibrahim said to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and tell them that the seedlings that they need to plant in their gardens in Jannah, the soil is fertile, but you need to plant something in it. The seedlings that you need to plant in order to make those trees are Subhanallah, Walhamdulillah, Wa la ilaha illallah, Wallahu Akbar. These are the days of dhikr. These are the days of takbir and tahmid. These are the days of building our paradises in this world and in the next. How do we do that? By remembering Allah, by worshipping Allah, by putting our trust in Allah, by being sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in all of this, we have the role models of the greatest prophets who ever walked on this earth, and in particular, the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst the true followers of the Prophets of Allah. Allahumma inni da'in fa'aminu. Allahumma la tada' lana fi hadha al-yawm dhanban illa ghafarta, wa la hamman illa farajta, wa la daynan illa qadayta, wa لا مريضا إلا شفيت ولا عسيرا إلا يسرت اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم من أرادنا أو أراد الإسلام والمسلمين بالسوء فأشغله بنفسه واجعل تدميره في تدبيره يا قوي يا عزيز عباد الله إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ به بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه وثلث بكم أيها المؤمنون من جنه وإنسه فقال عز من قائل عليما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين عباد الله إن الله تعالى يأمر Oh!
وبشرناه بإسحاق نبيا من الصالحين وباركنا عليه وعلى إسحاق ومن محسن وظالم لنفسه